Hello.
Hey.
Welcome. This is Sippin G&TV, the after show of Star Trek Discovery, and we're doing season 3, episode 4 today.
Yeah, I can't believe we're already 4 episodes in. It's been fast. A lot's happened. A lot hasn't happened yet. But yeah, so basically Sippin G&TV, it's a weekly recap and discussion, so basically an after show. And we will be doing this every Sunday as Discovery goes. So if you're interested in following us along, hit subscribe so you're notified when the next video drops. All right, so what happened this week? So firstly, we had a lot of focus on the crew's mental health on Discovery. Things are not going well. The crew is snarky, maybe disconnected from each other, and Saru is kind of trying to figure out how he can boost morale, basically. Which kind of leads to some awkward dinner parties and kind of general kind of conflict, but kind of figures it out along with the help of the ship's AI, how to kind of boost morale a little bit, at least temporarily. And then we also have Michael, who accompanies Adira to the homeland of Trill, where they're seeking answers on how to unblock her memories, because in theory she just has amnesia of her own life. But secondly, she knows she's a host to a Trill. And in theory, she should have access to all the previous host memories, but that hasn't happened for her. So they go to the homeland so that they can basically kind of finish the fusion between host and Trill, I would imagine. And that leads to its own conflict, because it turns out humans are not an ideal host. It kind of goes against their beliefs. But ultimately, they end up helping Adira connect with her host. And we get an insight into who Adira actually is. And turns out that the previous host was her partner. So now she's connected to her partner, who obviously died during the transfusion of the host from her to, from him to her. But she also has access to Admiral Sandeltal, who can give some information on where to go to find the Federation, which is a key point. And I'm actually kind of grateful they haven't held that over us for too long in terms of, like, you know, we had to go half a season before Adira finally got her memories and could tell us where to go looking for the Federation. So yeah, things are left off where the crew is kind of in a slightly better mental state. Adira obviously is in a much better mental state because she's kind of come to terms with her past, connected with her host. And Michael is kind of still carving out her own path. So,
and maybe have recruited a new member to the new Federation. The Trills are like, you call us when you're, you know.
Call us when you make some progress. We'll be open to that. So yeah, they came around really fast. But yeah, so I guess the first thing that was really noticeable is just like how the crew were interacting with each other, right?
Yeah, like, I really appreciated that this episode slowed down to just really dive into the issue of like what the crew members are feeling at this moment. They are like robbed, well, not robbed, but like they've been removed and transplanted from their universe, like from their family, their friends. And that has to just be such a huge
The things that tether you to your own persona and to your own, like, your motivation and your why, those things, you have to refigure all that out. And you also, there's going to be a lot of grief, because even though logically you know that probably most of your family members lived a long and happy life,
it's still lost.
Like, you've lost them, so it's the grief. They're all going through stages of grief,
Like, and having to work through it. And so yeah, I'm glad this episode slowed down to cover that. He had the, you know, really hard task of trying to mend and start the healing process. He was set, I feel like he was guided by Colbert, like, who, you know, was like, recognized the issue. And I think he also knew that Saru had the tools to be able to bring them together, so he was sort of orchestrating a bit, like,
but so was the computer.
The computer too, which is
like
kind of like a
threesome attempt, right?
So yeah, we had that hilarious, well, not hilarious, it was like, it is was hilarious in an awkward sense, like in terms of Giorgio being like, oh yeah, at least the wine is, you know, good. But like, at the end of the day, it was also a very like...
it's like the worst version of Thanksgiving.
Yeah. Right? But it was so essential for them to be vulnerable with each other to start the healing process. Because like, if they're pretending to be fine, then they can't really get to the root of the issue. It was only after they let out their frustrations that they're able to start repairing. And so, I think this episode was very important.
Yeah.
And necessary. Like,
well, it's kind of a reminder that at the end of the day, everyone on the crew is, well, I won't say human, but they're they're people.
Yeah,
and they people. Have an emotional scale and their emotional needs need to be met.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's cool that they address that because that's probably going to be something the crew, even if it's not a focus point in the season going forward, it's going to be something that they're going to be dealing with. It is interesting, though, that Colbert, right?
Yeah,
he seems the least affected, but then he's already been through the great loss of being in the caught in the mycelial network for a while. And obviously he has his partner, Stamens, with him. So for him, he still has his tether.
Yeah.
Whereas the others, they need to rebuild what their purpose in life is, I guess. So then the next main thing is we finally figured out like who Adira is, how she as a human ended up being the host for a thrill. And we got to kind of see how the homeland works a little bit, how the symbiotic relationship works, and what that means for her going forward.
Yeah.
So firstly, it seems pretty awesome that you have all these skills that you never have to take the time to learn and knowledge because you can just like build on everyone else's knowledge. But secondly, it's interesting because, well, obviously she's going to be a fan of knowledge. There's a complexity to her relationship within that's, I think they called it the circle, right? Because one of the circle is someone she was in a relationship with, Gray Tal. And Gray, as we can see at the end of the episode, is actually visible to her. So whether it's an hallucination, but it seems like they have very tangible conversations. And we can see that Adira is hesitant to share that she's having that experience. And it's kind of interesting to see how that will progress. How can someone have had a physical or at least a romantic relationship with someone who then died, who you forgot died because you've forgotten all your memories, and then you rediscover it. So basically you're kind of almost picking up where you left off in the relationship. But they are dead, but not dead because they live through you and they're visible to you. But that person has died. So any new experience or information is something you are taking in firsthand. So the development of Gray is going to be formed by Adira in a way. So it's going to be interesting to see if it becomes like an emotional crutch for her, if it holds her back, if it's emotionally supportive, like how will that work for her?
Yeah, I'd be interested in that too. Like, well, just some background, like in terms of, to jump back a bit with the Trill, I thought it was really interesting that they have to accept her, or like it has to be a mutual, it's a consensual like
joining.
And so that was really cool, and especially because this is something that is new and evolves the species, because the species itself is on the verge of like a extinction almost, right? Like they were having an existential crisis.
Well, yeah, because they didn't have enough hosts for the Trill, and they now, I guess, because Adira is human and there's been a successful joining, it's going to it's opening their understanding of who can be an acceptable host.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So that was really interesting. And also how they got there was kind of interesting, because Michael, who's like sort of not like the main character in this journey, in this episode, but she starts the chain of events by doing something very un-Starfleet-like.
Like a mercenary now, like
she's like Giorgio now, like shoot first. And, but like,
things not going my way.
But like, you know, that set the events in motion, and it's fortunate they had someone on their side. But so going back to the relationship, I think it'd be interesting because, like, outside of the narrative, we know that, this is a relationship that was announced before the season, like, because Adira is the first non-binary character in Star Trek history, and her partner Gray is the first trans character in Star Trek. So, like, the way they're positioning it, announcing it as like a relationship, almost makes it suggest that, like, I feel like they won't just have it be a one episode thing. Like, is there a way that Gray can become like a person, but have a physical form again? That's what I was thinking. Like,
so you think that might become Adira's personal quest going forward?
Well, like you said, it's kind of an interesting concept. Like, this person is a part of you, right? So that person, from a like personal standpoint, Gray can't exert any agency in terms of like physically in the world, so there might be some problematic aspects of that relationship then, right?
Sure. And Gray can't have any like solo or first-hand experiences anymore. Everything Gray experiences going forward is through Adira's filter, essentially, because Adira is the one who's processing what's happening around her.
So just from the outside information of like them, I feel like would they like, I feel like the writers might want them to have be able to be separate characters that they can play around with. Although, like, at the same time, there are so many things you can explore about, like, having people who are part of you but also aren't you. Like, I think that is another thing to
explore. Could be like, I mean, there are conditions in the human world where people can have multiple persons residing within a body. Typically, they experienced stuff separately. It depends on the relationship the different identities within have within the system, I guess. So maybe it's kind of gonna work a little bit like that.
Yeah, it's hard to tell. I'm intrigued in what
direction they're going to take with that. Yeah. It's also interesting that Adira is skeptical about people being accepting of it, whereas Gray is like, oh, I think Michael will be cool. I think we can tell
exactly,
it. So it shows that at least at this stage in their relationship, in the current format, they can have differing opinions. So.
Yeah, and cool. At the same time, like, the basis of their relationship seems very nurturing. Like, the memory we had of them, like, they were very supportive of each other, and, like, it seemed like a very warm relationship, so, like...
Well, yeah, but they've definitely known each other a long time. They both grew up as orphans together, so it makes sense that they're emotionally reliant on each other.
So it'll be interesting.
So the final thing to touch on, really, is the behavior of the ship itself. The ship took a turn in terms of how it was kind of communicating with Saru.
Yeah.
And it went from being very, like, answering questions that Saru posed to suddenly being like imposing opinions on him. Not imposing opinions, but the way it was communicating changed suddenly.
Yeah. It was like it went from Siri to like Scarlett Johansson's character and her.
Saru doesn't seem too concerned about the whole thing. He just seems to think, well, at the end he just said that he thinks that the source has merged with the ship, in which case it now wants to protect the ship and the crew because it's its current reality. So, and the mental health of the crew comes under that too. So that was interesting.
Yeah, it is.
I wonder how that will play into the season as well, if the ship becomes a little bit more independent.
Player,
almost like a character itself.
Yeah, exactly. And it is interesting because this isn't the first time we've heard of discovery with AI in the spaceship, because in one of the shorts, Discovery is a character.
Where somebody boards an abandoned Discovery and they basically embark on some sort of emotional relationship. It's interesting to kind of start seeing where that kind of started.
AI is just ripe for good storytelling, I think. There's so many stories that are relevant in our modern times to tell with AI. So that could be exciting for sure.
So that leaves us with a couple of questions heading in. One of the questions I had last week is where Georgia was going to be. I kind of thought she might go off a book just because, you know, she's an adventurous soul, but she is still on the ship. I'm not sure what she's doing on the ship other than being a pain in the ass.
Well, it seems like she was, you know, yeah, has something going on with Linus there.
Yeah, I mean, Linus kind of gave her some popcorn, and you know, her expression was very like fine. I'll let you like pamper me a little bit. Yeah, so yeah. Curious what's happening behind the scenes there. Yeah. I feel like that's just gonna be something they kind of pull out every now and again, but I don't know if we'll ever get any answers on that. It's just speculation.
Well, it's funny that in this episode she's basically comic relief, right?
Yeah,
like she was there to lighten the atmosphere, which is
which is kind of awkward because she's not the lightest of people. So yeah, the other questions we've already touched on it is like, how is Adira and Gray's relationship going to work going forward?
Yeah.
And then, of course, the main question is, where the hell is the Federation?
Yeah.
Luckily, I think we have a little bit more access to information on that, so we should be edging closer to hopefully making, I would say, first contact with the Federation, but considering we met Sahil already, it'll be second contact.
Yeah,
but
yeah,
hopefully a more informed second contact.
Yeah. Well, it seems like it should be a major one, because in the last episode, Earth said that Starfleet moved their headquarters.
Mm.
It should be a major outpost that they're looking for, right?
Hopefully.
So yeah, it'll be interesting. And and the biggest question is, where was Grudge?
Just been well taken care of by Vic.
Yeah, true, true. When are they coming back? You know, like,
I don't know, maybe he'll get to the Federation, he'll have beaten them there.
yeah. What took y'all so long?
Anyway, so that is us. That's our after show for this week. Mm-hmm. We'll be back next Sunday with our reaction and review and thoughts on episode 5. Still can't believe we're already 4 in.
Yeah.
So yeah, if you want to be notified of when that episode goes live, be sure to hit the subscribe button. We'll be doing a review of The Mandalorian episode 2 tomorrow from season 2. So if that's something that's of interest to you, check back in for that as well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks for tuning in.